Dig my custom machine. Hanging out here at the Surf Shack in California. I'm just Dharma Prince Clarity Ross, according to Longchampa. That's my outrageously wonderful, benevolent brother, Longchampa. Also, the same brother to you who is absolutely focused on everyone's mental health, the mental health of everyone. What a great brother to have, right? Isn't that great to know that there's someone who is absolutely focused on our mental health and has perfect mental health? How about that for reassurance? So he calls me Dharma Prince Clarity Ross because, like, let's say if you're Google or Yahoo or Facebook, whatever, and you're recruiting the best, you want to look for those who are going to help your company. So you look in the universities, other businesses, rivals, whatever. You're trying to pluck the best away, even from your rivals. Sure, that's how it's done here. So if they're keen on making their business better, how keen do you think Longchampa is in improving the mental health of everyone? And how keen do you think he is in recruiting the best to help him out? Okay, if you have a business and you want your business to thrive, what are you going to do? The first thing to do is get great employees. Obviously. Obviously. So he is very keen. So I'm just this knucklehead out here in suburban California, just a little surfer boy out here. And of course, California is a place where many people came to improve their mental health throughout history. And it was supposed to cure your suffering, your nervous, problems. And so the ancestors, etc., you came out here looking for nirvana, right? And they tried to find it. So it's kind of like this is what I have done out here is just focus on my mental health and this whole issue. So I'm very much keen on this mental health issue. Having gone through the whole suffering myself, all the way to the very bottom of the barrel of the worst possible mental health possible, which is total mental chaos, and then rebounding from that and getting the help of the Holy Spirit, and then going all the way through to where I am now, then having hindsight about it all, it gives me a pretty good perspective, and gotten a lot of help along the way from the Dharma Kings, Jesus Christ, Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma, Rama Maharshi, Longchenpa, Jemyang Kyentse Choki Lodron, and Padmasambhava, along with Nisargadatta Maharaj and Punja Ji and Krishnamurti and Yogananda, and probably a whole bunch of others that I'm not mentioning. But the initial six are Dharma kings, and they have perfect mental health. So all this help that I've gotten has apparently, Longchampa is recruiting, and he's had his eye on me for quite some time, maybe about 6 years. And he says, I want to recruit this one. Hey, why? So again, I'm just a knucklehead out here in California. And but he takes the long-term viewpoint, in the big picture. He says, down the road, this one's going to be very helpful. I want this one to work in my endeavor. Now, so what? How do I feel about this? Well, in the big picture, I'd have to agree with him. If I was in his shoes, I'd recruit me too, in the big picture, because I have a tremendous overall generalized big picture experience, hindsight experience. I've got a lot of rough edges, but those will smooth out. Those will smooth out. What's important is, for instance, the work ethic, the determination, the perseverance, the courage, all these qualities that I've had to employ, those are what you're looking for in the long term, in the long term. Now, in the short term, I don't know what I can do, to tell you the truth. I'm still subject to thoughts, but I have to cross that bridge here pretty quickly. And if you're subject to thoughts and contrasts and all this, then you're still a basket case. You know, we all are basket cases here. We all are basket cases here. Let's just be honest about it. That there's nothing wrong with just admitting, yeah, I'm a basket case. Okay, I'm still a basket case. But long-term prognosis down the road for me is very bright. According to Longchamp, he doesn't make mistakes, and I'd have to agree with him. I'd say, yeah. Okay, I agree with you, Longchamp. I'd recruit me too, if you want to be successful. It's just in the short term, but he takes, you know, the big picture. He's determined everyone is going to be brought to perfect mental health. So our outrageously wonderful brother and friend, Longchenpa, gave me something today which was just so amazing. I can't even say it. You know, it was just beyond amazing. I said, "Man, okay, you got me." I said, "Longchenpa, help me out. Show me. Give me a sign." Holy cow! He's something else. He's really something else. I mean, you just, you know, you want a brother like that, I'll tell you that. The miracle he gave me was so specific and so amazing and so compounded that you just have to laugh. That's all. It's like, he says, "You want something? Okay, here." You know, it's like, whoa, that's more than I expected. Holy cow, I was looking for something, little portent or something, and you give me this massive, you know, incontrovertibly great, can't miss it, obvious, you know, say, like, I am here, I am on the job, I am, you know, you're going to, you want some of me? You got some of me. So it's like, wow. Okay, then the knee board shows up. This is my new boogie board, sirloin bottom. That's nice. A piece of something. What's on there? There's a decal on there. Okay. Double rail sirloin bottom. I don't know what to do with it. It's beautiful white board. Looks like this. And so there you go. Body board. I don't know. I could have, I don't know what I'm gonna do with it. What am I gonna do with you? Maybe it's just part of the surf shack here, you know. It's like, ah, oh, man, I was checking out waves today. Ah, the waves aren't so good, man. I think I'll tape today, man. That's cool. Yeah, we're just taping today because, you know, I took a nasty fall on the skateboard, you know, and it's kind of flat, the ocean. Bummer, dude. So I'm just gonna sit here and tape. Yeah, that's what we do in California. No surf, no skate. Might as well tape. Yeah. So. Not in too much of a hurry here. So he calls me. Well, he suggests that, you know, that I'm a Dharma prince, meaning I'm working for Longchenpa, who's this perfect mental health expert, actually. And Buddhism is called the Dharma. The path to perfect mental health is called the Dharma. It's the way, the means that the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha is all one Dharma. The Dharma means the teaching, the means, the way. But it's all the way, isn't it? It's all the Dharma. It's all the way, and protecting the way. Be protective of the way. So I'm under obligations because I work for Longchenpa in his global health initiative. So I work for him, and so I have certain responsibilities, and I can't please everyone at this point. So, you know, nothing personal to anyone, but I have obligations and responsibilities, and I no longer can just, you know, do whatever I want to do. I can still do whatever I want to do, but it's just like I can say whatever I want to say. They don't tell me, I'm not told what to say, but they might give suggestions. Longchenpa Pama Samba, Longchenpa, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, Chandrasekhar and the Enigma Masters. They might give suggestions, those who work on this global mental health initiative from that angle. The Enigma Masters angle is from Vajrayana Buddhism. It's heavy Dzogchen emphasis. And I listen to it, but they might say, well, this probably wouldn't be the best thing to say, or this wouldn't be the best thing to do. Maybe we could do something better than that, or say something better than that. And I just say, well, yeah, okay. But I'm free. I feel free to say whatever I want to say. But I try to, be somewhat responsible without being fixated on like I have to say this or have to say that. No, I don't. I can say whatever I want to say, and I usually do. But they like that, because that means when something really important needs to be said, I'll probably say it. Like September 6, the global mental health alert. We can, I've talked about that, and maybe we'll loop back to that. But we're in a lighter mood here in the surf shack today. I'm recovering from my nasty, terrible spill from the skateboard. Wow. I think I am recovering. I don't know how bad the cut is. I haven't looked at it. It's pretty bad. I never looked at it, but I was told it's a terrible gash. And but overall, let's see. The hip is sore, knee is sore, but seems to be getting better. And back and neck and everything. It's but I think I'll be safeboarding for a while. It's a great excuse not to skateboard, isn't it? But we could always hang out here with the skateboard as we talk about mental health. As we talk about mental health, what better topic is there to talk about? It's very simple. Just admit I'm a basket case. We all are. But the key, what is the key to mental health? It's to say, I don't have many problems, I have just one problem. Okay, that's the ultimate key step to take. Okay, this is what will work for everyone. You stop seeing it that you have a whole bunch of problems, and you see, I just have one very severe problem. However, which is continuity fear, but that problem can be gradually evaporated, and it's helpless as long as you apply the right heat to it, so to speak, the spiritual heat, the heat of truth. It can't help but evaporate. So you're going to win no matter what. As soon as you see that really the only problem you have is a continuity fear problem, which means be it ever so humble, there's no place like home, be it ever so miserable, we will default back to what we're familiar with. Even if we glimpse the glory of truth, we'll go, yeah, well, I'm not used to it. What am I used to? Oh yeah, I'm used to this misery. Yeah, I don't like it, but I'm used to it. This is the problem we have. We default back, keep defaulting back to misery and fear, and believing that the reality is an abyss, and truth is therefore threatens us. So we just have to accept this. We will default back to misery. Yes, we will. So just accept that this is how it works. And so don't get upset with yourself if you keep defaulting back to misery. But what we default back to is continuity fear. Say, okay, I've gotten back into my continuity fear. Let me work on evaporating it some more. And you just keep doing that. That's all. So you're guaranteed freedom from mental distress. Guaranteed. All you have to do is just, with steady determination, evaporate your continuity fear. That's it. Because it is only that which binds us to all these other problems, so to speak. It's like pulling the weed up by the roots. When you pull the weed up by the roots, everything else is going to wither, okay, and go. If you leave the roots, poof, the weed comes back, right? So you have to get to the root of it, and the root of it is continuity fear. It's the root of all our problems. If we didn't have continuity fear, we would instantly drop all our so-called pretend misery, the confusion, our mental fear of reality. It would vanish as if it, in the instant, as if it never was, and we would completely forget about it, and we would have no idea that we ever even suffered at all. That's what would happen without continuity fear. But because we have such severe continuity fear, it doesn't happen like that. Okay, so relax. You're not going to be catapulted into reality. It doesn't work that way. Because we have free will, we can always pretend that were not in reality, which is what we're pretending now. So it will never happen that way, where you will be just catapulted into reality and you feel like you have to remain there. Your continuity fear prevents that from happening. So you evaporate it gradually, and you lose the fear. More and more you lose the fear of truth and reality. So that you feel, today, I feel pretty familiar towards reality and truth, and it's not such a big scare to abide in truth, or at least a reflection of it. If perception would be a reflection of it. It goes like that. You become less and less and less anxious and worried and frightened of truth and reality. Just gradually you become less and less that way. It's that simple. It's just steady determination in evaporating your continuity fear that solves all problems. So we're not in some atrocious situation, actually. Not at all. We're always in a very optimistic situation. All we have to do is pivot and accept that we just have one problem. Now, this is the genius of religions. It's the right approach in Christianity is to pivot towards just saying, I have this original sin, I have this one problem, sin, and that's it. There's not all these many problems. I don't have a cancer problem, I don't have a depression problem, I don't have this problem. I have a sin problem. I have just one problem. And then they tried to deal with it in various ways that we might say have had mixed results. And some of it's rather odd, actually. And I cannot recommend some of it, vicarious atonement and all these various things. That may make things even worse, just like think, because that means God, is angry and can crucify and wants, atonement and all this stuff. But it's not so. It's not true. God is not like that at all. But the idea of just sin, one problem. Buddhism, samsara. I'm suffering from the poisons of samsara. It's all samsara. Hinduism, maya. Maya. Christianity, sin. Maya, samsara. Here, it's continuity fear. I like that better. I like it better. Now, you say, well, Longchamp is an enigma master. He's more than that. And so I don't practice Tibetan Buddhism, never have. That's okay. He's looking at my mental health, not what form, by Tibetan Buddhist or this or that. What is your mental health outlook? He says, it's very good, blue chipper. Okay, so keep doing what you're doing, evaporate your continuity fear. That's the way anyway. So he's very ecumenical. It's an outreach to everyone, because all religions have it right, in terms of there's just this one problem. This is the key move you have to make in your mind, is to go from, God, just so many, many problems. I have so many, many, many problems. The world has so many, many, many problems. I just can't, how do I fix this and this? You go from that to saying, no, the world, I have just one problem, and that's it. I have the continuity fear problem. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity fear problem. Continuity fear problem is the only problem that I have. The world problem doesn't exist for me. Okay, and the vision of oneness, guru vision, so to speak, guru vision is, and guru vision is the only remedy for this continuity problem. It's the only ultimate remedy. When I reach guru vision, no more continuity problem. That's the goal. That's the only cure there is guru vision, which is really to see that nothing has ever been modified. Modification has never taken place. Everything is just the light and the intrinsic spaciousness, and which has not been modified at all. It cannot be modified. It's just a shadow place, so to speak. There's no impermanence, actually, at all. Where's the impermanence? Everything is light. Where's the impermanence? There's no impermanence. We're suffering from the grand illusion of impermanence. Samsara is a grand illusion of impermanence. Maya, sin. And sin refers to spiritual pride, which is what started it all. We wanted to see if we could be greater than God and change what we are, modify what we are. So we believe in modification. Of course we do. So we have this grand illusion of what we call nature, which is the belief in modification. And then we try to modify that and say, oh, I got to fix it. Now, you don't make illusions true and then fix them. Yeah. Oh, I got this horrible modification going on. I gotta stop that modification because there's no modification in reality. Okay, how do I stop all this modification? That's delusion. That's the ego. Guru Vision will show us that there is no modification going on. Actually, there's no impermanence taking place at all. From the ultimate standpoint, everything is eternal. Actually, because everything is the light, is it not? There's only the light. There's only the light and the freedom and the love and the peace. And that's it. So it's all eternal. All is eternal life, actually. So the goals of mental health, you say, okay, well, you say I'm a basket case. What do you mean? Well, look at the Nyingma Masters, for instance. I'll call them that. Longchenpa has this wonderful lineage from Padmasambhava through Longchenpa, Chekme Lingpa, and Jenyan Kensi Choki Lodro, Digo Kensi Rinpoche, you know, there's various, you know, just this amazing, amazing lineage of these amazing mental health experts, not only in this world, but in the afterlife, in transitioning from this world into the afterlife, and transitioning from the afterlife back into this world. They have it covered in 360 degrees. They have this 360-degree transmigrational awareness of what's going on with transmigration, reincarnation, everything. It's all clear to them. They have the whole thing perfectly mapped out and understood, recognized, know how to get the job done, no matter where we find ourselves. So these are just amazing experts. And so, you know, they... If you know, mental health is what? Well, when you decide to leave the world, turn your body into light. Just have it go into light, like Jesus, Padmasambhava, and thousands and maybe hundreds of thousands of Tibetans have done throughout history. I mean, turn your body, let your body just disappear, it just shrinks into nothingness, and just turns into light. That's mental health. Don't come back to this world, that's mental health. Be liberated from the afterlife, that's mental health. Be liberated from transmigration, that's mental health. And, you know, it goes on and on. So let's not lower the bar. You know, Guru Vision is mental health. Okay, nothing else is mental health. Guru Vision is mental health. Nothing else is mental health. Jesus would say the vision of Christ is mental health. Nothing else is mental health. Same thing, Guru Vision, vision of Christ. So that's our goal. That's everyone's goal. It's easy to reach. Mental health is easy to reach. It's just that all the distractions are very tough. Okay, very tough, the distractions, because we're so desperate, we think that reality is an abyss of annihilation, that we're extremely industrious in distracting ourselves from truth, so we won't be, you know, tempted by that so-called imaginary abyss. So we put great effort into distraction, so the distractions are brutal, very difficult, but mental health is simple. It's very simple. Just drop your thoughts. Right?
Oh, yeah.
But the distractions are warring with one another. It's, I need to defeat this one and then I'll be happy. You know, there's always a contestment. There's always a contrast. There's always something that's rising and falling and hope and fear. There's always hope and fear in thoughts, is there not? The play of thoughts. So just drop hope and fear and you're there. You got perfect mental health then. That's all. Pretty simple. So I'm not very good at anything. Even the videos I make are lousy. The graphics I make are kind of spiritually kitschy. It's kind of, you know, it's always sort of like, sort of a someone who tries hard, really tries a lot. That was my music. Music I had composed in previous life and things I've done this life. I really am earnest about it and really try. But I kind of just let it be what it is. And I say, I got something better to do, which is focus on mental health. So I don't really ever reach very, very much of a high echelon now, or ever really, with the polish. You know, someone that really thinks it's important enough to really polish it up in the right way. I just kind of say, you know, if they like it, they like it. If they don't like it, they don't like it. But it's time to move on. Got some other business, important business to take care of. We got our mental health to look after. If we don't look after our mental health, who's looking after our mental health? All right, ask yourself this question. I guarantee you someone is. And if you don't care about your own mental health enough to look after it and bring in some experts to help you, then someone else is looking after your mental health, and they don't actually want you to have good mental health. They make a profit and power and control over you having bad mental health. Okay. So keep this in mind. It's not something that we can just ignore, actually. We're taught to ignore it. So, no, you're fine. Just drink your sodas. And if you got a headache, take a pain pill or something. And you got, something else happened. Well, we got some medicine to handle that. Oh, you need this now? Well, yeah, we it's going to cost me how much? Back surgery cost me $220,000. Insurance doesn't cover it. Oh, wow. Yeah. So, the business of this world is the business of bad mental health. Okay. You have to, you know, recognize that at some point, if you don't look after your own mental health and don't care about it, there's somebody's going to say, "Yippee. I'll care for it for you," and they don't do a very good job, do they? No. The sun is peeking through, so I'm going to hit this down a little bit. So you first and foremost, you have to care about your own mental health, and then care enough to then be able to evaluate the experts that propose to help you. So Longchenpa, he said, "You know, would you like to work for me?" I said, "Well, maybe. I'll check you out. Let me see." Gradually. Well, it didn't exactly. I didn't know who he was at first, but I said, "Well, maybe. We'll see how it goes. You know, I'm intrigued by it." And then later on, yeah, he made a stronger appeal. I found out who he was. Then I could check on him directly in this way. And I've just gradually, you know, checked and looked and determining, you know, what his state of mental health is, because I care about my own. I'm not going to just, you know, turn over my mental health to somebody that I don't feel has my best mental health, doesn't know how to help me out, although I have done that at times and regretted it. So it's like that. You have to care about your own mental health. Where do we ever get the notion that we're not supposed to care about our mental health? This is bizarre, isn't it? These are the people that are living with all these pills now. I say, "Well, what are you doing for your mental health?" They have no idea what I'm talking about. So this is intentional. Okay, this is intentional. The business here in this world, our real responsibility is to look out after our mental health and cure it, get it cured. You know, get it perfect, is a better way to put it. That's our responsibility here. That's it. That's it. Because once we do that, we're free of this notion of a world, actually, nature and all that. We're free of that body. It's finished. It was all just a silly, silly pretense, actually. Yeah. Just one moment.
Okay.
So, from time to time, you get interruptions, you just move on. So, how do you think this happened? You know, I know it's in vogue now to blame all the religions for everything. Really? Religions are the fundamental institutions of this planet that help us with our mental health. Now, they may not have done a perfect job, and those who have poor mental health may have kind of tried to take over the institutions and twisted them in ways that aren't so helpful. But by and large, it's still a fact that that's the purpose of religions. And so we're trying to get rid of religion, really? We're trying to get rid. Who's behind that? Because we need the best mental health possible. And we need the geniuses, the ones who have perfect mental health to help us out. If we don't have those of perfect mental health, how do we know what perfect mental health is? We don't know. Like, wow, it's hard to set your sails in the right direction, isn't it? And they're getting rid of God and the Holy Spirit and Jesus and this and that. And they're saying those are fairy tales, blah, blah, blah. Who's behind this ridiculous nonsense? Who's behind it? What's behind it? What's driving it? Whatever it is, it's not helpful at all. Just the opposite. So we have to, the first step is to realize, I just have one problem, that's it, one very severe problem. And then secondly, start putting your attention on evaporating it. It's very simple, and how do you do that best? You start, turning away from bad habits that distract your attention. It's completely obvious, right? There's no big mystery to religion, really. There's no hypostatic union mystery to anything, actually. It's very pragmatic. You just have to evaporate your continuity fear. You do that by turning your attention to it as much as possible, and you accomplish that by, deciding to turn your attention away from bad habits. I mean, that's it. In a nutshell, that's all anyone has to do. That's all I've done. Still working at it. Bad habits always try to creep back in like snakes. Snakes, they keep trying. They keep saying, well, how about, they keep shedding their skin and say, well, how about this skin, And then they turn the skin down, they shed their skin, and there's another skin. How about this skin? It's a symbol for transmigration, reincarnation. You keep shedding your skin, getting another body, but also in this life, it's like you turn this down and say, no, ego, I'm not interested in being distracted from truth and mental health. And the ego comes back later, it's got a different, dress on. It's like different skin. Whatever, however you want to put it. It's like, how about this? Maybe this is what you're looking for. It's like, no. I'm not looking for bodies. Okay. I'm not looking for bodies. Not looking for thoughts. Not looking for any thoughts. See, thoughts are all about modification. Whether it's modifying something in a supposedly bad way or modifying in a supposedly good way. It's all the same. It's all the same. It's all the same. It's all the same. Exactly the same lie of modification. Do you get this? Are you hearing this? Because if you are, you are, I don't want to scare anybody away, but you're doing a great job on your mental health. Let's put it that way. Now you might be saying, well, I don't want to do too good of a job. Well, yeah, none of us do, particularly at any given moment. We might say, I don't want to go too fast here. Sure. Don't worry, your continuity fear will keep you company as long as you want it. It's like a shadow, your shadow's going to stay with you until you decide you don't want the shadow. The shadow play of thoughts. But again, is the idea of I can modify it in a good way, and I can modify it in a bad way. Is there any real difference in that if the issue is that modification doesn't exist? How is one better than the other, and what kind of judgment do we need to apply to it? Right? So all thoughts had to do with modification. All thoughts. Except the thoughts we think with God, but those are completely abstract. So here, we don't need to concern ourselves with that. Okay, so we say all thoughts have to do with modification. And modification doesn't exist. So what kind of sorting do we need to do? What sort of categorizing and sorting and culling and organizing and stacking and leveling and number crunching and data storing and algorithms. I mean, what kind of algorithms do we need to apply to nothing? I don't know. I don't really know if I need to spend time building algorithms that use nothing. Do we have to do that? There's no difference. There's no difference. There's nothing, nothing difference. No difference, zero difference between, hey, I can modify this in a good way, and hey, I can modify this in a, quote, bad way. There's no difference if the lie is exactly the same. The lie of modification is exactly the same in either case, is it not? So what is there to determine? What is there to choose between? What meaningful judgment can be made? Can any meaningful judgment be made there? Well, if not, then isn't that the last judgment, that judgment, that no meaningful judgment is possible? So that's the end of judgment, right? It's pretty simple. It's the distractions that are clever, right? We keep putting flowers on our grave and say, isn't that a lovely grave? Look at the flowers on it. And I'm saying, yeah, but how long are they going to last? They say, well, don't worry. Oh, yeah, we'll put some other ones on. How about these? You like these better? Why, are these going to last forever? Let me try these. Yeah. I mean, we're trying to make the grave attractive, you know, but it's not so attractive. So I feel okay. I was very nervous about getting this bodyboard, but right now I feel okay. I don't know what's going to come of it. I really don't. Maybe it's just some kind of stupid, superficial, hip thing. I don't know. But maybe I just bring it to the beach. Say, yeah, man, I'm cool. I probably like just planted at the beach. As I do some backwards running or something, just to say, well, yeah, I'm cool. I was here. I'm here to surf, but there's no waves, so I'll just run backwards and roll down to the water or something. I'll do something crazy. Unconventional. This is an unconventional game. I'm starting this unconventional game. It's the opposite of Pokemon. It's for the rest of us. It's Pokemon Go for the rest of us. Except you don't use a smartphone to play this game, really. That's the first unconventionality. And it's just all these unconventional things that you need to collect to get what? No prize. The goal is no prize for doing it. I don't get any prize. Except I've done it all. I've done all these unconventional things. So a couple days ago, I walked into Home Depot. It was like Tuesday. What's today? Wednesday. Also, it was like one day ago. Yesterday, I walked into Home Depot backwards. A little bit sideways as I had to go through the cars. I had to make sure they're looking better. But I walked, as I got closer, I walked in, literally walked into Home Depot backwards, taping myself on a selfie stick. That's one of the non-convention go. What should we call it? We'll come up with a name, right? Maybe you can suggest a name for this game. And I'll put a whole bunch of stuff up online for you. That you need to do these things to reach level one, you know, level one or level zero. I've reached level zero one time, and then you reach level zero a second time and a third time. Who can reach level zero the most times? So, right? Level zero where there's no payoff. Maybe I could use the board for a sunscreen. Oh, is that possible? Yeah. How's that? Oh gosh, it still hits me. It's still hitting me. Ah, that's not cool enough. Okay. Well, can I sit on the board? I don't know. I can put the board here as a nice little table. That's actually very comfortable, very lightweight. Wow. Getting blasted by the beautiful sun here. 98 today. Yeah, so we'll have a list game, and you reach levels, you reach zero number of times. I mean, you do these unconventional things like you have to take a picture, except you can't use a phone to take a picture. How about that? Wow. And you can't text while you're driving for this whole day. Okay, that's another one. I know this may freak many out, and they won't be able to succeed. You can't get to level zero for the even the first time, but for the us intrepid ones, we might be able to do so. No smartphone for a day. Leave your smartphone uncharged for several hours. Okay. And miss some notifications and friend requests. Uh-oh. I know it's tough. Very tough. But there are many unconventional things that run backwards, run sideways, do things that are actually very benefit. Just fall down dead, drop dead safely today, and do these things that get it buy a skateboard, sit on a skateboard. I call it safe board now because all I do is sit on it. These things are actually super helpful for your psyche. So we can make it a game, because everybody's into games. We can make this like the new game. It's the next big thing from Silicon Valley. It is the new game. So maybe we'll call it zero go. Zero go. We do all these things to reach level zero, which is what? We see no differences between positive and negative modification. The new game from Silicon Valley is zero go. So we're going to start playing zero go. You go to the beach with your bodyboard and you don't go out in the water. Wow. Ah. I waited for this board for a long time. It got held up. I don't know. Is there some transit problem? Some things arrived today. Maybe all the stuff arrived today. It's the day of arrival. Yeah, this is supposed to be a good body board. I don't know. It seems like it would be. I kind of want to get out at some point, actually, now that I have it here. But it's too doggone cold, and I could have bought a wetsuit, but I didn't. Now I don't have any money to get one. But, well, there's reasons that I don't understand. I wonder if you could use this in a swimming pool. Probably. Why not? But we'll let the Holy Spirit sort it out. Zero go. This is the new zero go. We'll do something with some. I'll come up with ideas, and maybe you can come up with ideas too. Maybe a sort of collective thing that everybody sort of comes up with these ideas of doing something that's, you might say, unconventional, that robots wouldn't think of doing, right? And we can share these ideas, zero go ideas, zero go. So someone says, "What the heck are you doing walking into Home Depot?" Well, I'm playing the hot new non-app Zero Go. Zero Go, yeah. And so we have to do all these things in order to collect these things and collect these actions. It's actually more like actions instead of shooting monsters. We're actually doing these actions. And once we collect all these actions, then that means we've reached zero level for the first time, and then we go on to another group of actions, and we accumulate, reach zero level as many times as we can, until ultimately realize, ah, there is no difference between positive and negative belief in modification. It's all just one lie. It's all just one lie. So there's no, zero to judge. There's no judgment to be made. Zero judgment. So we get to ultimately realize zero judgment. There you go. So I did a bunch of stuff today. Unconventional stuff. You know, tape yourself doing this. Tape yourself walking backwards into Home Depot. You know, that's like, that's everybody should. Let's play Zero Go. Zero goal. Zero goal. That's. Huh. What is this? Zero goal. Maybe the Japanese will love it. They'll start doing all this unconventional stuff. We're playing Zero Go. I'll go over there to Zero Go conventions. You know, they like doing stuff because their society tends to be very robotic. And it's like walking down. Someone told me, like in the Philippines, if you were like could walk backwards, like I do or something, everyone would think you're absolutely crazy. You'd be in an insane asylum. You just don't do that. There's a lot of stuff you just don't do it. You see, so there's all sorts of stuff in cultures where it's like you're not supposed to do that. But the harmless stuff, you know, and you say, wait a minute. Is this a little too much robotic control by those who would like us to remain mentally ill because they've learned how to manipulate this? Politicians are experts at manipulating our mental illness. Otherwise, they don't succeed. It's difficult to succeed. They're experts at it. So do not place your stock in politicians. I'm telling you this. They have many skeletons in their closet, and they're very shrewd. Amoral people who really know how to manipulate your mental illness, your psychosis, to their own advantage, to their own aggrandizement, which they think they're doing that to heal their own psychosis, they think, or actually is to prop it up, to keep them from collapsing into, you know, psychotic reactions. But so do not place your faith in politicians or politics. Put your faith in those who have perfect mental health. I mean, isn't that obvious to a mentally healthy mind? Isn't that obvious? But it's not so obvious to people. They say, like, huh, what? Yeah, that's a symptom of wow, I'm really, my mind is really foggy, you know. But if you don't get it, isn't it? If you want mental health, don't you put your faith and turn towards those who have perfect mental health who are here to help us? Of course. What else? Instead, we put our faith in those who are very, very, very sociopathic, psychotics, who manipulate us. The politicians are sociopaths. And we expect them to help our mental health. So they have no interest in you having perfect mental health, just the opposite. They want to keep you really messed up so they can stay in power, and they can everyone genuflect to them and treat them like they're the king and the queen, and what they say goes. And I mean, they need this kind of thing to prop up their own, you know, desperation, desperate psychosis. Don't put your faith in politicians. So we'll see. Zero go, zero go, zero go. We're playing the zero go, zero go, zero, zero go. Yeah, it's a new game, zero go. It really means zero go. We're calling it zero go. Have you played zero go? You playing Pokemon Go? Have you played zero go? Yeah, zero go is really cool. It's awesome. It's totally awesome. Can spread it around the world. Be a Zero Go player in your country. What are you doing? I'm playing Zero Go. It's the newest hot thing from Silicon Valley. I mean, it's unbelievable. It's funded by the. It's presented by the Enigma Masters. How about that? That's completely cool. That's their game. That's their app. It's the Enigma Masters app. Zero Go. Ha! Hey! Zero Go. Hey! Zero Go desu. sirloin bottom to this. Sirloin. Sirloin is what they make the cover of golf balls out of. So it's a very slick and smooth bottom to the board that just slips through the water. They should make it out of skateboard wheels. I mean, you talk about slippery. Those slipped out from underneath me in the twinkling of an eye before I could have any idea what's going on. It's ridiculous. I thought I was on top of it, but just like we think we're on top of our mental health, on top of the world, on top of what's going on, no, we're not. We're basket cases. Don't think we're on top of it. Turn to the Longchenpa, the Nyingma Masters, in perfect mental health and say, help, 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 help. I need help. I want help. Maybe I should pour water on the board and anoint it, you know. There we go, anoint the board with water. Blessings to the board. Oh my gosh, there, it's anointed. Domini Patris, Patris, I Filii, I Spiritus Sanctu, Sanctus. In nomine Padre, et Filii, et Spiritu Sanctus. Amen. I've just performed sacraments for the boogie board. Ooh, the knee board. Ooh, spreading it along. Wow, spreading it here. Okay. Are you supposed to wax these boards? I don't know. Do you wax styrofoam? I have no idea. I'll have to look that one. I have to Google that one. Do you wax a knee board, boogie board? I don't know if wax would go on it. It looks kind of cool without wax, but it's kind of slippery. It's very slippery, isn't it? With water, without wax, it's kind of slippery. Your sirloin is probably super slippery. Yeah. Let me try it. Let me pour some water on the sirloin. Pour the water on the sirloin here. In nomine Deus. In nomine Padre, et Filii, et Spiritus Sanctus. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So you can say Deus, Father, Deus, God, in nomine Deus. Padre, in name of Padre, Father. It's, how's the water? It's, well, it's pretty slippery. Yeah. It's pretty slippery. You can't see the wire probably, but this top is actually, I feel, is even more slicker. Holy cow. So we're hanging out here in the surf shack and just focusing on mental health. How simple it is. How simple it is. How simple it is. And just see all problems actually just are just one problem. Just one problem. We just have one problem. Just that puts this fast relief upon your mind. And that's necessary. As long as you see you have many problems, guess what? Those problems are infinite. You will see infinite problems and you can never make any progress. You're just tilting at windmills, actually. Tilting at windmills, tilting at windmills. One moment, please. Okay. No progress. You'll be spinning your wheels. Every problem you think you tackle, there's a thousand more. And each one seems different. See, I got a different approach. But when I approach this one this way, it hurts the other approach over here. You get absolutely nowhere. In fact, you go downhill. As long as you see a multiplicity of problems, you have no hope. You have no hope. As soon as you see I have just one problem, you have massive hope. Okay? This absolutely is the key to your mental health, is accept that you actually have only one problem. However, for your, so you don't get too nervous about this. Well, if I only have one problem, blah, 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 blah. You know, what happens if it gets solved? Like it might just luckily get solved and, oh, I'll catapult it into reality. No, because the one problem we have is extremely severe. It's the continuity fear problem. It's extremely severe. You will find that it takes a great deal of determination to try and, you know, to evaporate, not try, but to succeed in evaporating this continuity fear. It takes a great deal of effort. That is for sure. This may be the last hot day. Yeah, the last lost hot day of the year here. I don't know. They say it's going to cool down appreciably. We have to go down to the desert to get some heat. I like the heat. There's something majestic about it. There's something intense about it. It's not wishy-washy. It's full blast. It's very evaporative. I love the evaporative heat. Feels like it's evaporating your sins away. You know, well, it is your sin away. It's evaporating your continuity fear away. It feels like something's evaporating. That's great. Principle of evaporation is very key. I mean, it just thins out. Continuity fear just thins out because familiarity grows. And when familiarity is there, continuity fear is not there. And you say, I can handle this. I can handle this. Like when I fell, I already had practiced falling a bunch of times, tumbling and falling, which kind of freaked me out, but I did it in a safe way, you know, on foam cushions and stuff. So when I actually did fall really bad, I got banged up really badly, but mentally, I'm fine. It didn't shock me at all. Amazing, huh? Why? Familiarity. So this shows you the awesome power of familiarity that has over us. As we have pretended that we're something other than what we are, that we can modify what we are by believing we're these bodies, which constantly seem to be modified, although actually it's a great illusion. We've gotten familiar with this, and so it's what we have to do is we have to go in the other direction, get familiar in the other direction. So familiarity is very powerful. It has a hold on us. We're so used to believing we're something other than what we are. So it's the key issue, familiarity. And familiarity gives rise to this continuity fear, this dread, like, this is scary. I don't know why, like free-floating anxiety. I don't know why it's scary, but it just feels scary. So, you know, you go to a psychiatrist and say, Doc, you know, I've got this anxiety. Well, what are you scared about? I don't know. It's just, I feel scared. I feel like, you know, maybe it was your parents or something. No, it's continuity fear, Doc. Okay? They need to upgrade their, you know, manual, mental health manual. It's all continuity fear. It's free-floating. It's 360 degree. It's like you go to a new place and you say, Doc, I feel uncomfortable. I just don't like, I'm not sure if I fit in. I got some anxiety. Well, did you just move to the new place? Yeah. Well, you know, you'll get used to it. You'll get familiar. Once you get familiar, take 2 aspirin and get familiar with it. And guess what? After a while, you settle in, you do you do all your routine, you can set a routine, everything, and in autopilot, you know how to drive here and there. After a while, it's like, I feel comfortable here. Thanks, Doc. Did a great job. So, familiarity is the snake that we overlook. It's the one thing that we overlook, and that's what gets us every time. So we have to very consciously insist that the only problem I have is a continuity problem, continuity fear, familiarity problem. The only fear I really have is continuity fear. That's the only trouble I really have is continuity fear, because that's what binds it all, the fear. That's it. I don't have any other problem at all. No other problem exists for me. Not one. Not even one. Not even one. Which is totally true. Not even one. If it weren't for the continuity fear issue, we could have this body turn into light this instant, and then we could turn it back into, appear. It would appear again as this body in the next instant. Be a piece of cake for us, actually. Easy. No problem whatsoever. And we'd do it with a laugh. as if how silly we thought that that was so difficult. Absolutely nuts. I thought it was difficult. It's the continuity fear that binds us to this nonsense of believing in time, space, process, and form. It's absolute nonsense. Hey, don't slip out from underneath me again, or at least tell me when you're going to do it. I got to chastise the board. Say, what were you doing? Good Lord. But I'm sure it's all for the best. So, what do you play? Zirogo. 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 Yeah, we're playing Zirogo. Zirogo is the new hip, absolutely super hip. The super hip, super freak game. Zirogo. Wow. And you might be saying, what does this have to do with mental health? A great deal. Because we have to be pragmatic in evaporating our continuity fear. And our continuity fear builds and builds and builds as we get more and more fixated. You have to do it this way. You have to do it this way. This is, you know, I got to walk into a store this way. Yeah. And so we have silliness guiding things. We take the silly serious, and the serious we think is silly. So you know, the other games actually lead you in the wrong direction. They really do. They lead you in the direction of frivolity. What we do is more unconventionality. We have things that shake our psyche up and say, hey, wait a minute. Like falling down. That's very helpful, actually. I said, I didn't realize I was so nervous and worried about falling down. And I spend my life trying to avoid that. You know, this is such a big part of my life, right? As you get older, it really becomes this massive part of your life. You're not even aware of it, how it creeps into you. I'm just familiar with caution, 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 caution. Just be aware of it. Just be aware of it. And you do things that just you didn't think you could do or hadn't thought of doing. It just helps you stay flexible in your mind. And it has an effect on your continuity fear. It's a way of approaching it from the physical standpoint. And we can do things from the mental standpoint. We're doing it from all standpoints, 360-degree standpoint. A cat walks by. If I say, hello, kitty, it doesn't pay me any attention. If I make a sound it's not used to, pow! See, they're on autopilot. Some sounds are used to. Other sounds they're not used to. What's that? I got up very early this morning. I'm probably going to start feeling tired. Feeling drowsy. You're feeling drowsy. Yeah. You're believing in modification. You're believing, I got to play Zirogo. Zirogo. Playing Zirogo. Let's play Zirogo. So, you know, how to do that. We'll start it off, and then maybe it'll expand to other platforms. I don't know how to do it. I found out that in Facebook, you can't really access Facebook unless you're signed up. Sorry about that. I thought maybe people could, you know, access my Facebook page without signing up for Facebook. But you can't. What a bummer. That's really a bummer, isn't it? Yeah. So, I mean, I have to, you know, do it some other way. YouTube doesn't lend itself to that at all. A blog would lend itself to that. A website would. But I hate websites, you know. I really do. I've done so many of them and have never gone anywhere. It's like evaporated my life. So many websites. This. Nobody's interested. Nobody's interested. At least on Facebook, people actually like what you say. It means they looked at it. But I've had, you know, websites for years, zero visitors, you know, zero, nothing, years, zero, just no comments, nothing, absolutely no activity. It's like, wow, that's really, but on Facebook, at least there's some activity. Occasionally, you have to turn down friend requests. I don't like doing it, but occasionally, you know, based on the responsibilities I have, you know, I have to at least have some parameters. And some people have to keep them on as friends, but ignore the posts, because the posts are very much positivism, you know, and they just don't go any further than that, which is not good. Positivism is the great enemy of truth, actually. It's not what the ego uses to distract us away from the super positive. And some people, you know, have just affectations that they're pursuing, which aren't good. Yeah, I'm not here to, you know, I'm not here to just, what's the word? You know, to trifle with stuff. I'm not, you know, I don't trifle with people. It's, you know, serious business. Mental health is serious business. So I want, you know, I want people who are serious about their mental health. I can tell those who are serious about their mental health, this is great. They're saying, hey, you know, I'm a basket case. I got to do something about that. I'm very serious about it. That's what you're looking for. You're not looking for, you got to repent. You got to say, look, I'm a basket case. How do I get well? Oh, see, all problems is one problem. Okay, and then how do I get free of that problem? I'll evaporate the continuity fear. You want to see people taking that step. Repentance, really, way of putting it, means to accept you have just one problem, but it's a very severe problem. See, we keep trying to avoid the severe problem by fragmenting it into so many, like, I've got so many problems. And we think, well, if I just tackle each one of these little problems, yeah, but there's millions of them. And after that, there's millions more. And before you know it, your life is over. So it's way better to admit, I got this one very severe problem, and then see if you can find the remedy for that problem. Because if you do find the remedy for that very severe problem, that's it. I mean, your problem is over. You're done. You're finished. So that's a much better way to go about it. So I try to help others, you know, see this. I don't really succeed so much, actually. The wisdom of it doesn't really dawn so easily, right? We keep thinking, no. It's easier if I split my problems up into a bunch of different problems. It's not. Because what's holding you to all those different problems is the continuity fear. And if you get rid of those problems, guess what? You'll generate other problems. So you just spin your wheels. You know, you just are spinning your wheels. How loose are these? That's a little loose, that one. Yeah. Just spin your wheels. That's all that most people are doing, is simply spinning their wheels, not getting anywhere. You could easily exchange all sorts of problems. I used to have this problem, and now I have this other one over here. That one, I used to got rid of that, but I have this one. And you go through life just shuffling the deck. Just shuffling the deck. It gets you nowhere. Except the return ticket. So, if you have only one card, how much deck shuffling can you do? So right away, you got a leg up on everything. Say, hey, wait a minute. It's the card just down right here. I don't have to shuffle the deck at all. This is the card. This is my one card I got. Okay, now let me put all my focus on this card. And how do I get free of this card? That's all I need to find out. And it's pretty simple. It's very simple. Just listen to truth. Keep listening. Keep contemplating. Keep focusing. Keep desiring. Keep asking for help. Keep watch your mind. Pay attention to your mind. Pay attention. And drop the bad habits. Pick up better habits that help evaporate the continuity fear. And you just go at it like that. It's very simple. Very, very simple. Very simple, sir. Yeah. Hot day. Feeling it now. There's no breeze. Lovely. Lovely day. We don't get these very often here. We treasure every day here. We're weather addicts. best weather in the world, you have to say. We're completely spoiled, actually. So consistent. So beautiful. Anything less, it gives me the, you know, horrors, the creeps. I'm always terrified, like, going somewhere else. What? Leave this weather? I'll be miserable. But actually, when people have bad weather, they do other stuff. They focus on other stuff, making things. Here, we just enjoy the weather. At least I do. Quiet mind and focused on what is simple. Good weather is simple, is it not? No judgment is simple. Zorogo. Let me do Zorogo. Gotta have a Japanese sounding name to the Zorogo. That's great. What can I do? You could post the stuff on Facebook. That's the thing about Facebook, is you can post. That's really nice, but I know some people don't want to. If Facebook is not this terrible thing, you know, it's. I just ignore the advertisements. I don't even know they exist now at this point. The doggone tagging I've got to get rid of is just crazy. You have 20 new notifications, 30, 40. Somebody liked a picture you were tagged on. That's all it is, you know. You think, you're hoping, well, maybe somebody has a comment. What you really want are the comments, right? That's what you're looking for. Somebody commented on your photo, what you said, and you read what they comment. It's interesting. It's feedback. It's feedback. I like those who comment. That's how you're supposed to do it. So I often comment. I seem to be like the only one. And I don't know. Most people have these stock comments on Sri Sri Nanamaya. It's Jaba, 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 Jaba. That's great. But that's all that's ever said. And I will say something else. You know, I'd say, you know, this is great advice from the Bhagavan. Let us all take it to heart. And Guru Vision is not the result of any karma whatsoever. It's inherent intelligence. It has nothing to do with karma. Wow. That's great to hear that. Awesome. Awesome advice, awesome pointer by the Bhagavani herself. But no, it's just, Jaba, which is great, this is great, but for me, I want a little more variety of feedback. And so there's these stock replies on Facebook, I find, stock replies. I'll try to give like an intelligent, thought-out reply that I feel is helpful for everyone's mental health. I will say something. But no, it just tends to be stock, or it's like. I take the time to actually say something. Isn't that amazing? People on smartphones say, it takes too much time to type that. I'll just like it. Hit the like. I did something. No, not really. Not really. A little bit. But some are just likeaholics. You know, just, I could do something. It's better to type something. I mean, people can, you know, thank you. I can do that on a smartphone, I think. Either if you can, it's not that smart. Cat's already learned that sound now, so it doesn't bother it anymore. See, it already knows that sound is not threatening. First time, look, okay, now no threat, okay. It's already got that in its mind, very quick. Oh, what time is it? Oh, it's getting to be... we're losing the long days, aren't we? What can I do? We're in a crisis, global mental health crisis, and so I had to use the summer to go. I couldn't waste, you know, it's the days of wine and roses are over. The summer wind, you know, came blowing in across the sea, lingered there, touch your hair and walk with me. All summer long, we sang a song and strolled the golden sands. I lost you to the summer wind. Yeah. Don't ask me to sing it like Wayne Newton either. I could probably do it if I heard what he sang. You're the great entertainer. So the summer wind has come in, you know. And it's now September. And we're into this time now of global health crisis, of materialism, and it's like too much for everyone. Materialism, really, it's just massive cancer. It's a massive psychosis, actually. Global psychosis, materialism. We're not seeing that we have one problem, and we're not working to evaporate it. And we're becoming more and more robotic, more and more efficient towards materialism. What can we produce? How many more tiles can we produce, and pavers, and new designs, and this, and this, and this? It's like putting flowers on our grave. How many cool flowers can we put on our grave before we jump into it? Or slither into it? How many flowers do we need to put? Maybe we should not worry about putting flowers on our grave. I have some monuments to me in Europe, my previous life, and you see pictures of them. Some people put flowers on the monument. You know, they still remember to put flowers on my grave. yeah. Well, okay. Thank you. But those flowers don't last very long. I appreciate it. I think. I don't know. Because it's positivism. But there was some... I was trying to point towards something beyond positivism. Maybe some people were helped by that. Yeah, I see a picture of one of the monuments, and I said, "How is it? Is it keeping up?" They keep it up. It looks okay. It's kind of forgotten in a park or something, or you know, a little place with trees and stuff. And occasionally, someone wanders by, and someone might bring some flowers there, something like that. But generally, you know, you don't get so many. It's kind of bird. Mostly you get bird poop, you know. It's like, do people clean the bird poop off your monument? I don't know. Maybe they get tired of that after a while. So, why are we so keen on the grave? You know, that's bad mental health. Just turn yourself into light. Turn your body into light and be done with it. Come on. Of course, they got those little relics of that too, and little glass cases in these little, on these monasteries and caves in Tibet, and curtains and stuff. And that, there's the relic, you know, the fingernails and hair. Burn the body into light, and people come, and you know. But it's a nice relics for people to show, that shows them that this is possible. So that's very nice. But you might as well, turn those into light too. Longchenpa was asked not to do that because he said it would be helpful for people to have a lot of relics from you. Okay, couldn't, so I think what was it, Manjushri, Vajradhara or Manjushri asked him, as a great, you know, grace of God asked him to, can you not turn your body into light so that, and then have him burn it so there'd be many relics come out? And he said, sure, no problem. And there's great many relics. They burned, cremated his body, and out of that, a great many relics were there. And so that helps the faith. That's one way of helping the faith. People like to have that. But it's better to meet Longchenpa directly. That helps your faith even more. I'm not a big relic person, actually, at all. Never have been. You know, something belonged to this guru, something. You know, I'd rather meet the guru directly than have a necklace they wore or some bracelet or, you know, anything, whatever. You know, just, you know, that helps. That helps. But I'd rather meet them directly. Because that really helps our mental health. It's like, wow. At least they know about me. And you know what a basket case I am. And they're working on it. they're going to help me out. Oh, great. That's good to know, right? It's very great to know. So I'm recovering from the Great Fall. Must mean something, right? What, speculators pulling the rug out from underneath us all, or one of the presidential candidates in America going down, having the rug pulled out from underneath them in some way? It'd be something. I've got some portents, very strong portents actually, and they continue to accumulate in shocking ways. I don't want to say much. It's really disconcerting, actually. Very disconcerting. You don't want any of that kind of trouble. Let whoever wins win. Let the knucklehead get into office, and then we'll see if we can survive them. And we'll focus on our global health, global mental health initiative. Just focus on that. Forget the rest. Don't worry about politics, all that stuff. It doesn't matter. Focus on global mental health initiative. Global mental health initiative. Not coming from the UN. The unness. It's coming from the oneness. Enigma Master's in the house. Doesn't matter what the boilerplate is. Everyone has boilerplate, their institutions. Not everyone is a, Rinpoche, a real top dog. Not everyone. Okay, so they have boilerplate, meaning pretty stock responses, and this is blah 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 blah. That's nice. Just you've heard it before, as many times. And may all beings be liberated from samsara, and may the void and this and this and be able to. Yeah. It's like saying Jesus died on the cross for your sins, saved by the precious blood of Jesus. That's boilerplate. Okay. But beyond the boilerplate, then you start finding expertise, and then you start climbing the ladder, and you start finding out some heavyweights, and they really are astonishing. Jamyang Khyentse Choekyi Lodra was a heavyweight. He could take you through the death process just amazingly, astonishingly, clearly, directly, unmistakably, into the bardo, into the afterlife, and guide you in the afterlife with no problem whatsoever. This is the acumen they have. Death doesn't faze them in the slightest bit. They know exactly what's going on. They know exactly what you're going to experience. Exactly the different phases you go through. And how not to be, intimidated by any of them. They have all the right, advice and remedies all the way down the line. I mean, it's just astonishing. It astonishes me. It really does. Who does it not astonish that anyone should have such acumen? And they've passed it along, and they've protected it and nourished it. Longchenpa in the house is in the house. He really is. Don't sell them short at all. Don't sell the Nyingma Master short. Let me say that for sure. Don't say, "Ah, oh, they can't do this. Ah, oh, they can't do this." Yes, they can. They're world beaters. They're liberated from samsara. Samsara doesn't tell them what they can and can't do. They're not hung up on good and bad modifications. They say, "Well, we've really learned how to do these good modifications." They're not hung up on that. They're not tricked by that. So what is it they can't do? Well, don't put anything past them in terms of super positiveness. Longchenpa himself has perhaps appeared more than any other guru I have ever heard of to successive generations, the best and the brightest. He addressed them. He has his eye on them. He cares greatly about it, what he does. And he has nurtured this tradition, Enigma tradition. And he appears to the best and the brightest to make sure that it is thriving. And he promised before he passed on, he said to successive generations, listen, I promise you that if you want me to appear to you to help out the Dharma, I will. I absolutely promise you, I will. All you have to do is ask me and I will. Now, he said, I can appear in dreams, I can appear in visions, or I can literally physically appear. Whatever works for you. Doesn't matter to me. He appeared to me in a dream. I didn't even know who he was. But I made a great appeal for help, for the mental health of this world. I said, if anyone wants to help me out, I'm all in to help out the mental health of this world. If anyone wants to help me, I'm happy to make your acquaintance this very moment. Very next night in a dream, he showed up, said, I'm here. I want to help out. I'm going to help out. That's how extraordinary Longchamp is. He is just astonishingly quick in his responses. So quick, it brings me to tears, actually. That anyone cares that much about us to not delay in their responses like this, but to ask him and he immediately responds so fast. He's not sitting there thinking about like, well, should I? Do I really want to help the world? Or he's all in. So there's no hesitation on his part at all. So I talk up the great merits of our extraordinary brother, Longchenpa. I keep talking them up, and not many get it yet. They're too struggling with many problems, they think. Just realize you have one problem, and then guess what? You'll be able to spend a little time maybe getting acquainted with Longchenpa. It's like you're on the battlefield and you're facing all these foes, and you say, I got nobody. I don't know what to do. I'm so disorganized. I'm doomed. And help! I need a great general. Boom! Instantly, Longchenpa appears on the battlefield. He says, "Don't worry, I got this. No problem." It's like, oh, wow. He's not concerned at all. He's not scared at all. Not bothered at all. He's not tricked by multiplicity, diversity, and multiplicity of modifications. He's not fooled at all. He doesn't see many enemies on the battlefield. He sees just one continuity fear. That's it. Easily defeated. As long as we use steady determination. I'll remember what Longchenpa did today. The Enigma Masters. Put them all together. Jam Yang. Pamasamava. I'll remember this. For sure. It was so, so amazing what they did today. You had to experience it for yourself. It does not explain well. Because you try to this part of it, and this part of it, and this part of it, and this part of it, you know. But to experience it all, just all as one experiencing, it's just like, wow, it was all there. If I use words, it's going to string out in a certain way, and you lose the cohesiveness, the oneness of it. It's gone. That's why words are so treacherous in so many ways. And I have to use a lot of humor, a lot of lightheartedness, so we don't get fixated on we realize it, that we, when we string descriptions out, we lose the right now totality wholeness of it. You can't help but get a different impression, get some impression that's not it. So we don't worry too much about did we get it. We'll get it when we see it, when we experience it as a totality. That's when we have this feeling of getting it. And so we're just sort of encouraging and helping and evaporating here. And at some point, you'll have an experience. Maybe you'll ask Longchenpa to help you out, and he will do something for you. The Nyingma Masters. I use Longchenpa to just mean the whole Nyingma Master, Nyingma lineage. We'll ask them, ask Longchenpa to do something for us. Bam! He does. And you say, wait a minute. Did that really happen? It did, didn't it? Just all like that. Wow. And it really is very stunning. It's very stunning. So, one of the great steps to mental health is to realize those with perfect mental health have our backs and are helping us and care about us. That's supremely important, is it not? We don't have to struggle with it so much. We're not all alone in this struggle. We are not all alone at all. Longchenpa promised me, I will not let you slip back down into transmigration. I promise you this. That means he will do everything necessary to help me out. Great for me, great for him. He gets another, real strong helper in this great, truly righteous crusade. You want to have strong knights in this crusade. So he gets another strong knight. We have a knight that looks out upon the battlefield. No battlefield. What battlefield? There's nothing there. So they're relaxed. You want a knight like that. Calm, relaxed, no trouble. Everybody else is screaming and veer, right? The knight is there, just poised. And you say, okay, we have a chance. We have a chance. So it's very important to go over this in such a way that we don't get too nervous about it all and start fixating. Just stay loose, relaxed, expansive, not uptight, not overly concerned. We've got it. You've got it already. It's already in the bag. It's very simple. It's already in the bag. You just don't try to draw differentiations between different styles of modification. That's all. It's very simple. You've already got it. So just breathe a little breath of realization, right? I've already got it. It's so simple, I've already got it. No doubt about it. So simple, I've already got it. No doubt about it. No troubles, no worries. These crickets have a nice little syncopation going on here. Got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Gotta be rock and roll music if you wanna dance with me. What happened was, to help subvert society or liberate it, subvert it, change it, modify, whatever you want to talk about, whatever you want to look at it. People look at it different ways, but music, dancing is very important. Dance was very important. The way that people danced was very, it's very set, and I remember in the 50s, the 60s, or before rock and roll, it's the cha-cha-cha was, and the two-step, and the various, you're taught dances in school, this is how you dance, this is how you dance, and it's okay, this step, then this step, and this step, and turn, this step, and that step, and your hand, way you act and everything, it's all very robotic, and they're designed to, for various social reasons, some maybe helpful, some maybe not so helpful. But then rock and roll came along, and what it was selling people is, in rock and roll music by Chuck Berry, is gotta be rock and roll music if you want to dance with me. And so it tried to get these converts and get these people saying, hey, you know, if you want to dance with me, you know, we got to dance to this rock and roll song, because that's how I dance. And you get enough, you know, queen bees doing that and alpha dogs and stuff. And they're out there on the dance floor and they say, wow, they're dancing the twist. They're dancing this. And then the man or the woman will say, I don't dance that old style. That's old fashioned. If you want to dance with me, you got to dance rock and roll. So it completely changes the culture. Dance, actually. It's very powerful. You know, dance forms are very powerful, actually. Because young people, for some reason, like to dance. For women especially, love to dance. I don't know why. I really had no interest in dancing. But they just seem to just, women seem to just have a tremendous love and urge, and dance is so important. It's sort of how they show you how I want to be related to. You know, this is how I want you to relate to me, like this. So they set up these dance patterns. If you want to dance with me, this is how you have to dance. I mean, what choice do the guys have? I mean, the guys got to ask, and women can turn them down or accept. Or then they said, nah, not that. I want to dance with you. Okay, they say, they let the guy know, you're the one I like to dance with because you dance the style I want you to dance. So they control culture that way through dance. Dance is very powerful. Which is why religion often outlaws dance, because religion is supposed to control culture, not the women, you see. Religion has the answer in terms of perfect mental health. Women do not have the answer. Men do not. Women do not. They're both basket cases. So you cannot have the flesh telling that which transcends the flesh how to run its business. And yet that's what's happened here in this world. It's called materialism. So, gotta be rock and roll music if you want to dance with me. And this ushered in a new era, and in hindsight, it was a materialistic era, very materialistic, extremely materialistic era, that started out as if it wouldn't be, but it's turned into, like, you know, some uber materialistic era. Horrible. Krishnamurti warned us about this. He says, you think you're getting liberated? No, you're not. There's a whole bunch of folks who are going to migrate into this world, and they're spiritual materialists to an extreme extent, and you will be blown away and captivated by them and captured herded into very severe control systems, materialistic control systems. This is what Krishnamurti saw. This is what he warned us about in the 50s and the early 60s. He was absolutely right. He had help from the Dharma Kings in all this. He was connected to the Dharma Kings, Krishnamurti. He himself did not have perfect mental health, but he had very good mental health. He was connected with the Dharma Kings. And so he warned us about this, and so it's happened. So we need to dance a different way. And we can't have the women and the men determine how we dance. You need to have the mental health experts determine how we dance. Like, determine how we skate. How do we skate? Well, we sit on our skateboard. It's called safeboarding. Sit on your skateboard, just sit there. Use it as a meditation seat. See, that's different use of the skateboard.
Zarogo.
So think about some unconventional stuff you could do. Just like walk in a circle, kind of like walk sideways in a circle, or a figure eight, or, you know, how you walk, the line you take in walking, hop up on a bench, balance on one leg on a bench, hop off on one leg, do some hopping, do some skipping, do some jumping, do some clapping. In a sedate, non-decadent way, always in a non-decadent way. tiptoe, shuffle your feet, do a little boogie step as you go along. Roll. Whatever happened to rolling? Nobody rolls anymore. Know your role. corporate society, materialistic society. Know your role. They give you the roles. This is how you roll. You roll out of bed and you go pump it up. Pump up the volume of materialism. You can't roll that way. That is not your role. It is not your role to roll along the ground. That is not your role. Know your role. Well, I'm playing Zorogo here, and I have to attain zero level at least once. So I've got to do these various actions that help me attain zero level. What? Know your role. The dragon. Know your role. Sorry, dragon. Right now, I'm playing Zorogo. I'm really into it. It's a new hip game app. You know, I don't even need a smartphone to play it. That's how hip it is. It's like so hip it's already gone beyond smartphones. It's like using Grace of God, which is even more hip than smartphones. Hey, how about that? Can you believe it? Can you dig it? I can dig it, he can dig it, she can dig it, we can dig it. Can you dig it, baby? Woo, 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 woo. Gosh, the dusk here is awesome tonight. It's like a velveteen dusk. Man, I don't know. Where can you go that's better than California weather? I hope heaven has got better weather. You know, I hope reality has better weather than California. It's just so awesome tonight. Good Lord. The blue has turned into a dark blue velveteen. And the horizon is this peachy, sort of soft peachy orange. And it's so quiet. And the crickets are just cranking up the volume to 12. They got their orange amps up to 12. We forget to tell California how much we love it. I think most people forget it. But California, I love you. You know, it's just the weather you have given is just stupendous, stupendous, stupendous. Reminds us of something, doesn't it? Ever freshness reminds us of the beauty of ever freshness, how we create freshness continuously, moment by moment. We fundamentally are creating freshness. Everything is already liberated in the now. That's how fresh it is. Now, if they could just make the water, the ocean water warm, then it'd be like unbelievable. It's the one drawback. The guys say, yeah, you need a 4.3 wetsuit, not a 3.2. 3.2 is not good enough. That water's cold, chilly over there. You know, it is. Now you got to have a 4.3. It means a thick wetsuit. Ah, that's a real pain. You know, can I have a 3.2? Nah, you're going to get cold. Ah. Well, the fish like it. I don't know how they can handle it. I don't know how sea creatures can handle their existence. I just don't get it. Pretty amazing, huh? Most of the life on the planet's in the ocean, in water, lives in water. How's it do that? They might ask us the same question about land. How do you live on land? That's really amazing. Yeah. Maybe I can do beats here. Beats by Zorogo. Zorogo Beats. Hey, we got a rave going. Dance music, man. Get some dance music going. I've always got some beat going. Like, what is that? I mean, we used to have good dance music. That's just like so robotic. Like, wow. You just know that's going to start. That just... Really? You can't be more creative than that? Makes disco music sound great. I miss disco music, actually. When they play it in the store, I love it. Compared to the stuff they have now, oh my God, it's just beautiful music. That's good dance music. And then, you know, before, you know... It's just, I can understand, I guess, in hindsight, the disco fever. I mean, it swept you away. It was very, like, into oblivion, kind of. Just disco dance into oblivion. Which is what people wanted to treat their psychoses. I mean, they're just so messed up. We're all basket cases, keep that in mind. So you better treat your basket case-ness very intelligently and wisely. Otherwise, you will remain a basket case. So I had a super nasty fall 2 days ago. I was on, what, Labor Day? Hey, yeah. I think it was 2 days ago, yeah. And, you know, I'm feeling great. My mind is feeling great, and everything's fine. If I had not been attending to what I attended to, it could have been a very different story. So this shows you that when you have momentum of mental health, and you act on the intuition of the Holy Spirit, the grace of the Holy Spirit, and your brothers who are so helpful, the Dharma Kings are so helpful, you're able to keep the momentum going. And it gets better and better and better and better and better. And so, next step is to take the next step. Is that not true? Is that not true? Hey, I can use this as a giant mouse pad too. Now I'm really cooking with gas. This is great. Maybe that is the next step. You see this? I'm using this as a giant mouse pad. Yeah, as long as the mouse pad doesn't. So, yeah, I mean... Here we go. I'm going to click stop catcher with my new giant mouse pad. Cool. Totally cool, actually.